everybody. Welcome to The Final Stitch. I'm Natalie, and I'm here today with Liz, and we have some great information for you on borders. We've gotten some great questions.
Gotten lots of questions. A lot of people have asked, how do I make my quilt bigger with borders? And I think sometimes that question is, you know, the pattern says to add this size border, and I want to make it bigger. Can I do that with more borders?
Yes, and you absolutely can. So just because we add a 6-inch border doesn't mean that you couldn't add an 8 or a 10-inch border. You just have to remember that whatever you put on one side, typically you're going to put on the other side and the top and bottom. So your quilt will expand. If you do 10-inch borders, it'll expand by 40 inches all the way around, 20 on each side.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, minus your half inch for your seam.
Which threw me off when I first started doing quilting, because I would say, oh, I need to add 10 inches to make this fit what I need to, and I'd add a 10-inch border, but then
right.
on both sides, now it's too big.
Exactly. So what you'd want to do is divide that in half, because you're putting it on both sides.
Right.
The other thing you could do is, if a lot of times I'll have a quilt where it's either square or it's shorter than I wanted it to be and wider. Mm-hmm. And so you can also add borders to top and bottom only. You can add borders just to the sides. Like, borders are one of those cool things that you can turn your quilt into whatever shape you want it to be and whatever size it needs mm-hmm. to be without doing a whole lot of other things differently.
Right. Like, I have a nephew who is very much taller than I am. And
yeah.
so when I make his quilts, I add a little couple of border rows so that they're nice and long and fit over his feet.
That's great.
So
that's awesome.
We do that.
There are like a few little tips and tricks. You know, people say that it's best if your border is about 3/4 the size of your biggest block.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, there's some math that you can Google. Maybe we'll come up with a little sheet if you want it. I don't know that it's necessary, because I live by a freer quilting
yeah.
style.
Yeah, there's no rules.
I feel like you don't need to follow the rules, but there might be.
It's a guideline to get you started, and that can be really helpful.
Yes.
But there's definitely not a, like, somebody's not going to give your quilt back because your border's
absolutely
too big.
Absolutely not. No, we've never had that happen. Mm-hmm. Never. Not once. It can be fun, though, to do alternating sizes.
Yes.
You know, where you have a skinny and a wider, and that, and sometimes if you throw a solid in, it will give the place to rest.
Yep. And you'll see a lot of times on Missouri Star quilts, we'll have an inner border that is made up of the same material as the backing or background, mm-hmm. and then a nice big bold print on the outer border.
Right.
So you can do that to help set off the inner yep. piecing and patchwork that you've done.
A lot of times we do that to draw a line between the busyness of the blocks mm-hmm. and then the busyness of the fabric that we want to put on the outside. We want there to be a resting place.
Yep. And then you get to really enjoy that crazy
and it,
print
it is,
that
it's
you
like
love.
Putting a mat on a picture in a frame.
Exactly.
And so it really makes that picture in the middle stand out.
So speaking of that, one of the things that I tend to do is turn a small panel into a giant quilt. And one of the things is kind of continue to add frames and frames mm-hmm. and frames. So I've brought one of my quilts today that starts off as a 24x40-inch panel, so it's width of fabric, but you take off the selvages, and then it's about 24 inches wide, and I've turned it into a king-size quilt with just borders and borders and borders. So yes, I'm insane, but I like it that way.
It's a beautiful quilt, though. I can't wait for you guys to see this.
So we'll get this out, and then we'll share it with you.
So okay. This is the panel right here in the middle that she started with. It's got the Eiffel Tower and some beautiful poinsettias on it.
That's right. And it came with some coordinating fabric. So a lot of times there's a border stripe. And so the first thing that I did was cut the panel, this black here.
That's part of the panel.
It's part of the panel. And then this is the border stripe that was part of that line. So the mm-hmm. first thing I did was cut a big chunk of that border stripe to go all the way around.
And this is one of those times, too, I think, where you would use the pattern on the fabric maybe to decide where you're cutting,
yes.
as opposed to just saying 10 inches and let the lines fall where they may.
Absolutely. So even though it might be a hair wobbly even in places,
mm-hmm.
that didn't bother me as much as I wanted to make sure I kept that green line on the edge. So that's
right.
absolutely right. And then to keep that green line, I actually had to cut a little bit away from that, because mm-hmm. your quarter-inch seam would otherwise kind of take over that quarter-inch green line.
That's
so
right.
you want to let the fabric sometimes tell you how wide to be. And this here also is a mitered border. So
that's something we may need to get into on another episode, because mitered borders can create really beautiful continuous patterns. but they're a little bit more difficult than your straight borders.
Yeah, they stretch my brain, and I have to do all four mitered borders in the same sitting, because if I don't, then whichever ones I don't...
When you come back, they'll end up different?
That's right, because my brain had time to rest and change its mind.
Yeah.
And the other thing I just do want to show you is, like, here, where it is mitered, it's not perfect. I didn't line up a perfect poinsettia, but your eye sees that the red, the poinsettias, and the black
continue. The pattern continues even if it's not an exact match.
Yeah, so you don't have to stress over that. I know some people get really meticulous, and that's awesome and gorgeous, but you don't have to.
I love it. I think it's very cool. So then these next ones, it looks like you did straight piecing and straight line additions.
Yes. And one of the things about this border is that it is a directional print, but I didn't care if it stayed upright the whole time.
Right.
So you can see on the sides that it's actually, I had
decided
to put it into the side.
It's upright to the middle.
Right. And then another one of those guidelines that's not really a rule, but sometimes can help your eye be happier with it, is at the bottom, it also is right side up, so that if it's hanging or if you're looking at the quilt, both the top and the bottom
instead of
are
having
facing,
them face opposite same, directions.
Right. Doesn't really matter, but sometimes that if it's bothering your eye, you
well,
might try
and it's,
that.
Yeah, it's an idea for another way to love your quilts.
Yeah, absolutely.
If it bothers you one way, do it the other way.
Yes. So then...
And I noticed you wanted these all facing upright.
Yes.
And then you have a different color here in the middle, and then a small stop, a medium, another small stop.
Yep.
And then you've got the big outer border.
So along the outside and in the red and green frame, they're two different fabrics, and that's totally allowed.
That is also okay. Yes.
And again, I let the fabric tell me how wide to make this because I wanted to show off the flowers and to find a similar color way. But obviously
it's
red and green,
it's a great way to combine and use prints that you love in a way that's a little bit non-traditional.
And this also came out of, I love Christmas prints, and so I wanted to throw all of them at it. And this was a good way to keep adding reds and greens and golds and shinies.
Yeah, and I love how you have, so you have the things that are a little bit mixed up, and then you have really steady, same fabrics, and then you have a little bit more that's mixed up. So it's like a good pattern, you know, for the eye to rest and enjoy, and then have a little party, and then another rest. You know
exactly.
What I mean? It's just
yeah.
kind of interesting and fun.
And it breaks it up a little bit.
Yeah.
So the reason I share this, too, is to show you, you can use as many different borders as you want. I had to stop at a certain point because it hit king size, and you can't keep quilting once it gets bigger than that.
It's a little difficult.
And I didn't want to try to put something even bigger than that under my machine at home, so I had to stop where the long number said to stop.
Yeah.
But you can do great big wide borders, little bitty skinny borders. The sky's the limit, and you can just throw your favorite fabrics at your quilt.
Mm-hmm. Options are endless.
Yeah.
It's one of those things that you can do anything that you like. Just remember, the main rule is whatever you add to one side, if you add it to the other side, you're doubling your width and height.
Absolutely.
So.
And so that's the other thing that happened to this really quickly. I kind of thought I was aiming for like a on-the-couch TV-size quilt.
And it got big
but
fast.
But because my borders were so big, man, real fast, that got to be
before
a great
you
big
knew
quilt.
It.
Yes. So now it goes on the bed instead, and that's great.
It's beautiful. Well, Liz, thank you so much for sharing your quilt with us today.
Thank you.
I love it, and I hope that other people are inspired as well. Be creative with your borders and have fun, and let us know if you guys have any questions.
Absolutely. Send us your questions. We love seeing questions in the comments, and sometimes you can email them to our customer service team. We also
get
questions there, too, on Facebook. Subscribe so you see more videos like this, and make sure that you tune in next time.
See you next time on The Final Stitch.